And I started with a very simple question, but a little bit tricky. And to go through, I prepared a presentation dividing these four parts. First, a little bit brief what we know about this urban theme, what we think we know. Then I want to emphasize on empirical evidence I've been collecting during the last 12 years, focusing on those three topics, expansion. So, three aspects, urban expansion, heat, and informality. Then, in the part three, I'm going to try to link those three that are in a narrative, put it together with the conundrum of sustainability. And then to close up upside down, as normally like to start with conceptual things and then go to operational things. This time I want to do it upside down, just to emphasize that the challenge might be in our concepts, in the empirical crisis that we are currently going through. So what do we know? So then if you can help me, please, with this picture here, if you can just raise your hand. If you agree with this picture, this is New York, it's Manhattan, and 1,600,000 inhabitants, you think it's urban or not? If you think it's urban, just please help me and raise your hand. I see some hands that are not up, so then I think, okay, people thinking maybe like me. Then you have this example, beautiful palace in my hometown city, in Punta Arenas, in the very center. Also, do you agree that this is urban again? Would you say, would you classify that in a map as urban? Then it becomes a little bit more complicated. We have the Welches in Patagonia, only 150 inhabitants, no picture taken for myself, from an helicopter. Do you think this is urban? Who thinks this is urban? So you see, then I start with some controversial there. You know, applied geography, human geographers, they think differently about that, no? What about the glacier? This urban. What about this? Some abandoned mining, something like two sailing days from Punta Arenas was exploded in the 70s and now it's abandoned. What about that? Is that urban? Well, my good PhD student thinks that yes. So let's go to that though, because when we classify the thing as urban or not, we have been shaped by the demographic dimension of what we understand as urban. This guy was a genius, Davis. He wanted to make a global statistic of population. But for that, you have to be tricky. So urbanization for him is a situation when a substantial portion of population lives in towns and cities. But you have to define towns and cities. But that definition is arbitrary. It's based on a particular threshold that every country decides. So different countries use different thresholds, and comparisons then become very tricky. For instance, in my country, it's 2,500. In India, it's 100,000. And then everybody's repeating, now more than 50% of population lives in urban environments. So that is actually a kind of strange statement, if you think about that. The most important thing is that this approach produces an urban dichotomy, where the things are classified as black or white, urban or non-urban, rural, whatever, something else. In the case of the mining, that would be not urban, somewhere far away, classified as whatever, but not urban properly. However, when we look at the way the cities they do develop, if we look at space, we see continuity. And then if we look in time, you see also this continuity. Rather than a categorical thing, black or white, urban or rural, you see a continuous thing in space and time. And I will go to this conceptually and operationally in the very way we measure what we understand by urban. So this dichotomy, urban-rural, it doesn't reflect this continuity. To me, it's fundamental for science to start measuring urban, understanding urbanization as a continuous process rather than a categorical one. So, what empirical evidence do we have to challenge these assumptions we inherit from 20th century? I will go first to expansion. And then I have here a picture. So, first question, if you now think, I asked before, that is urban or not, now I ask you, do you think this is a city? Somebody that's thinking that this is a city, or a town, or a settlement. Do you notice something particular in the picture? Well, the light is not that good. Do you notice something particular about the picture? Something that calls your attention and you would like to share? Looks like a normal city, or settlement, or town. There is something going on. Does somebody know which one is this one? Matthias?
Russia, city in Siberia somewhere.
Very close, not Russia, but Ukraine. This is known as Chernobyl. And the fact there is that there were no people. And that you can see clearly here, 2002, 2018, and you see that that urban structure remained exactly the same in 16 years. Why? For the reasons that we all know, but mostly there are no people. No people, no urban expansion, no growth. On the contrary, when you start to look at other places where there are people, you see this, Las Vegas, you see Tehran, 2 times, somebody 10, 15, 20 years in between pictures, this satellite imagery, in Dubai, even going to the ocean sometimes, not to talk about fast urbanization in China. Indeed, yes, could be tricky to say that Chernobyl, it is a city, because cities, they do grow, they do expand. And you can define them as growing structures, as very clearly shown in this NASA image. In time, they do develop, they do evolve in a physical sense, this. This is not showing you any population dynamic. You know that people are living there, but what you see is a physical process. So here's some numbers, you know, from Latin America now. So you have here city of Santa Cruz, somewhere in Bolivia, close to the Amazonia. How much it grew? 17 square meters every minute during the last 20 years. Look at the size also, you know, and then you see that the size was from 68 square kilometers up to 220 in terms of the built-up area. Santiago de Chile, 24 square meters every single minute permanently during the last 20 years. This is a part of this room. So in a couple of minutes, Santiago would be building exactly this room. Pay attention to the size again. The size you see is bigger now. Almost 400 square kilometers and duplicated up to 700 square kilometers. And then Buenos Aires, you have 57.6 square meters every single minute. And now pay attention also to the size. You could also look at population. Well, Professor Stern would say the numbers are too small, and I'm really sorry because it comes from a paper. But it is really interesting to see that this is a measure of speed, actually, in terms of land consumption, where you see that correlation is higher with the size of the city than the population. What it means, as the bigger the physical size of the city, the faster it expands. And that is a sort of regularity you can find whether you test that here or there. And well, but most of you are German students, and you heard about shrinking cities all over the place, I think, you know. So here you have the map of shrinking cities. So but shrinking, and here I want to be really clear, it is again a demographic conceptualization. It's only looking at population. Sometimes I found myself arguing with colleagues saying, no, but also you see that some vacant land appear and there are some buildings that are tear down here and there and say, haha, yeah. But you have to look at the whole system. Let's look at the whole system. I have the emblematic shrinking case of Germany, the city of Leipzig. and there you have it. Then the numbers you see, size. Size 188 in July 1989, 10 years after 99, more than twice. 41.4 square meters every single minute. So while losing population, you see that it grew at 7.85%. That is the rate of expansion every year. And that, to put it in context, is three times the global average, which was 2.4%. So, messages. While shrinking demographically, while losing population, the city expanded three times in a physical sense. We can actually define cities as growing structures in a very physical sense. What you can see in this image is actually that, lights. A physical change is taking place there, and as I show you with the figures, every single minute. This is a physical transformation of the Earth. If you look, let's say, in terms of Europe, there is a nice, interesting figure. During the last 100 years, Europe was adding the size of the Audimax every single minute, persistently during the last 100 years. Cities are growing structures. I was showing you maps in two dimensions. We do this thing with remote sensing, mapping. Some of you are studying here geomatics, very interesting stuff in two dimensions. But now I want to bring, because it's really important to understand what this means. It's not a simple change in a pixel in a map. This means material consumption, stock building materials. As you see, they grew from 60s, no, more than 50% over the last 50 years in terms of weight. That is exactly the stuff that you can see in the picture up there in the satellite imagery. So particular materials stuck in landscape and they remain there for decades, centuries sometimes. So with expansion, there is an entangled material consumption, a particular way that we consume and accumulate materials on landscapes. And this is a very important thing. You have the figure here for Germany. In 2010, this amount of stock materials in the whole country was 15.3 billion tons of building materials. In the year 93, it was half of that. So in 10 years, Germany duplicated the stock in terms of buildings and infrastructure. This expansion is a regularity. It is something that is happening in all cities. We go and measure in China, in Africa, everywhere, cities are going to be expanding. There is a second regularity, which is called urban heat island, as you see here in this map. When you measure the temperature inside the cities, it's going to be higher than the temperature surrounding the city. This is something that you can call thermal equilibrium, as is here. And it's a very simple thing. If you imagine that the city is a black box here, the temperature inside, and then you have here the outside, urban heat island can be defined as not equilibrium, but temperature inside is bigger than outside. And the second feature is that this temperature is always increasing. So, as a whole system, cities are not only expanding, they are also warming up. It's a whole system. That means this non-equilibrium, it means, in this case, that cities, they require to dissipate, they have to do something with that heat. They have to send it out to keep the internal processes. There are particular systems doing this type of behavior. And they were called in the 70s by a Nobel Prize, Ilya Prigozhin, dissipative structures. The structures that they are able to maintain themselves, like you, like a monkey, like a microbe, They maintain themselves, so they are far from equilibrium. They are warmer than the surrounding, of course. They are not in equilibrium, no? And they have to dissipate the heat, which is indicated here with this symbol. So all the heat that is produced here maintains urban function, but has to go also somewhere. Cities were defined already in the 70s as self-organized systems, keeping their functioning by themselves far from equilibrium, or far from thermal equilibrium. When you have a system in a state far from equilibrium, then you can expect that internally there are going to be a lot of things going on. What is the opposite of that? The opposite is homogeneity. If you would have, let's say, an homogeneous universe, we would not have galaxies, stars, and planets. All things would be at the same temperature. No changes, no interest. Would be really boring, actually, universe. But as we have cities that are warming up, far from equilibrium, we can expect that internally, the structure is going to be highly heterogeneous, highly interesting. So then now I want to go there inside. I was looking at expansion and heat, system as a whole, the city as a whole, the black box. Now I want to go into the black box. I want to see what is going on here. And indeed, when you look at the urban heat island inside the city, as these maps are showing, then you see that there is a sort of correlation between what sort of structures you have there and what is the temperature, which is shown there. No? So you see the higher the build, the higher the temperature. I was speaking about the expansion, no? Regularity, looking at the whole system, then giving some figures, linking to the material dimension, you think three dimensions, also time, then heat, and now informality. So what is informality? Well, it's a really important phenomenon where the people basically, they are in a process of building up dwelling without standards or with low standards, no infrastructure, low quality materials. And as you can see in the image here, it's again a global thing. You can think also in terms of what is going on in Europe in terms of migration and what is happening with those settlements of people that they are immigrating and then they are building some informal stuff while waiting to cross to UK or in some border somewhere down in Europe or crossing to Italy, etc. So it's a process is also taking place here. So just to show you how it looks like, so here you have some pictures, some settlement in Bogota in Colombia. You see clearly unfinished buildings, no roads, dirty roads, also garbage on the streets. This one in Montevideo, Uruguay, with one of the highest standard economic standards in Latin America. But also you see here, so building a process, bad quality materials. Here you have in Bolivia, in Cochabamba, you see clearly how they were tracing the roads to make the parcels and then the people they are occupying those things. So you see that it's not only a spontaneous process of single families coming somewhere. No, these are, they are agents behind this thing, promoting and fostering this process. Sometimes this is in my hometown in Punta Arenas, built in really extremely vulnerable places. No, here you see the house hanging there almost in the ocean. What is interestingly linked to the idea I was just saying, when you look at the at heat, what is happening with temperature in cities, is that when you look at informality or urban development, formal, informal, the types of neighborhoods built here and there, you see that there is sort of an equal urban differentiation, which is clearly explained there in the picture. You see the central business district, the rich, no, buildings for business and companies. And just in the same plane, very close by, you see this other informal development taking place there. No? Strong symmetries
at close distances. It wasn't the same I show you with temperature, having not just seen also strong asymmetries, but now in terms of temperature at taking place at close distance. To introduce the aspect of time with this informal urban development, now it is understood as a linear process. No? So this is the linear understanding of informal development, where you have the arrival, so the people, they get there and occupy a land, there's nothing. So then they do some improvement, they build some dwelling to live. Then eventually the agencies from the state, they come and they give titles, property titles to them, and then they expect that infrastructure provision will come in a moment. No? But that is really linear. So then behind this, there is idea of progress, that the families are gonna be increasing in the quality in time. No? We tested this with empirical evidence. I'm not showing here, but if you're interested, we have a couple of papers on that. And showing that rather than a linear process that goes always from less quality to a better quality, that you see a singular path of single families without any relation or with less relation to improvement in a sense of time. Rather, you see that they can actually get deteriorated. So the linear model doesn't need time. Exactly in the same way as I was showing that demographic understanding of urbanization doesn't need time to understand informal urban development in the way it really takes place, that can be, as I'm saying, moving to better or to worse, depending on particular characteristics of families, you need to include time. And then you have time symmetry. They can improve or they can deteriorate, basically. And that is the interbreeding model that we develop that is proving this thing. Now I want to link these three aspects, these three examples with empirical evidence I was showing to you with the sustainability conundrum. How these things they do relate, or how these facts, these regularities, these homogeneities and heterogeneities can help us to understand to what extent cities are or not, in my test, sustainable. So as I said first, connected to expansion, that is a physical process, no? And then you can clearly trace or see the materials that are accumulated here and there. No? And with that base, you can imagine, no, that this is a continuous process. There is nothing saying, nothing indicating in the empirical evidence, a signal of reduction in the speed of expansion, in the speed at what we are accumulating materials. On the contrary, I told you, the bigger the city, the faster the expansion. No? So then we are facing the impossible hamster dilemma. No? A hamster burns with few grams and is duplicating its size for the first 7 weeks, as is shown in this graph. But now imagine if rather than stopping growing at the 7 week, the hamster continues duplicating the size in time. What happened to that? It becomes exponential. Actually, as it's saying there, after 1 year, you will have a hamster that weighs 9 billion tons. And it will be actually eating the total annual amount of maize produced in the whole entire world. So now just think about the implications of this expansion and urban material growth that I was showing before. Also thinking the bigger, the faster. There is a particular reason why in nature, the things, the far from equilibrium structures that can be called living structures, like you, the hamster, and cells, they stop growing in a moment. To look now at this growth in terms of mass now, not talking about demography anymore, that's 20th century, I introduced the concept of technomass, which is basically, as is shown in the picture there, basically thinking like technomass, like biomass, sorry, like how ecological structures, they grow. Well, also anthropic structures, they also grow in time. And it's defined as the amount of materials that have been suffered transformation due to human labor. And when I'm saying labor, Professor Kissima, imagine that I'm pointing to economics, and it's exactly what I'm trying to do, introducing the factor of labor into this thing to start to understand, you know, how the factors, they are helping in producing this behavior. When you look now, thinking now in terms of now this ecology, in ecology, in ecological terms, ecosystems, all stuff from Odum, metabolic parameters of a forest ecosystem. Then you have the biomass. What you see, it's not the impossible hamster. The forest ecosystem grows very fast in the beginning, as you see. PN is net productivity, PG is cross productivity. You see that two of them are higher, really fast. But after a certain moment, they go under, and the biomass stabilizes, and the size of the ecosystem remains same, basically. And it is exactly the same thing that happened to you or to the hamster. You're born, you grow, and until a certain point, you stop growing. When we don't stop growing, we're in problems, actually. But you stop growing, and then, as the black arrow is showing, something very important is taking place there. Complexity starts to increase. In terms of ecosystems, they start to close material and energy cycles. So, not because ecosystem, they stop growing in terms of the mass, they stop developing. On the contrary, they are much more complex. If they would not stop growing, they would be spending the energy that they could spend in increasing complexity, they would be spending that energy in the building up process of a structure. So now I don't have time to go in detail into this, but just think that they are, as it was before, no? Biomass production in some agroecosystem here, and there is this other technomass production in an urban ecosystem somewhere there, no? So then I was showing you urban expansion. Indeed, technomass is produced for ecosystems, for urban ecosystems, no? To sustain urban functions. And that is a driving factor of the expansion of the agricultural boundary. This is the expansion axis. For every 10% of increase in arable land, you have 2% increase in urban land cover per capita. Global regularity, measuring a sample of 400 cities. So the loser is not agricultural land, basically, here. Now, that's also another myth that we inherit from 20th century. So when cities, they do expand, you are pushing away the frontier of agriculture, really far further away. And then you have another process in terms of urban ecosystem, which is densification. So let's say you have one single house and it's turned down, and it's there, you have a building like this Shanghai building there. That is densification. Now you have more weight per unit of surface. We were measuring, actually, now I'm trying to link the aspect of expansion, but now thinking in terms of technomass, thinking in terms of volume and time with energy demand. And we were testing how much energy cities they do demand for cooling purposes. Can we relate that to the amount of technomass? And we found that there is a tipping point around 30,000 tons per hectare where this relationship stopped being linear. Here, it's a very simple thing. It's like you grow one unit of energy, one unit of technomass, two units, two units. After 30,000, that relationship becomes superlinear. Remember superlinearity before with the hamster. When you go into that function, then you are running into problems because you cannot keep the pace of growth in that thing. So in terms of exactly this, exactly the same scheme I was showing before, when you have energy dissipation, see these are dissipative structures, that you have here now the input of energy, and then you have eventually some radiation, and then you have, remember, this is heat, this is heat. Heat is the most degraded form of energy. You can't do anything with heat. When the universe is gonna end up in 13,000 billion years more, then it's gonna be only heat. Homogeneous heat, no interesting structures as you stars and galaxies. So do we have a problem in terms of energy demand that everybody's thinking? I don't think so. And that's my point with sustainability here. We have sufficient amount of energy from the sun. 173,000 terawatts, trillions of watts of solar energy. That's every second, because that's watts, So you need it measuring also time, which is more than 10 times the world's total energy. Only thinking in terms of solar energy, there is no problem. We might have challenges in terms of adjusting policy here or there, but in terms of energy availability, there is no problem. We have sufficient there to harvest. The problem is here, because as increasing the energy entry in the system, you have to get rid out of that energy. You have to dissipate the energy. So my statement here, which is quite strong, that the problem connected to energy and cities is not demand. The problem is dissipation. We cannot dissipate the amounts of energy that we are putting into cities. I'm not even thinking in terms of global climate change now, just in terms of energy demand. There is no way. The planet, the sun, they have an empty space of 3 degrees Kelvin, infinite, where they can dissipate the excessive heat, but not cities. And the fact that cities are warming up is actually a signal of this problem that we have to face now. Now you think what happened when cities, they go, all of them, around the figure of 30,000 that I said. 30,000, it might be, I don't know, that maybe female house people would be you. Closer. We cannot get rid out of that energy anymore. And now linking that with vulnerability, in terms of heat, this high heterogeneity, it can be also linked to particular social classes. People living in particular areas of the city with low quality materials, as these maps are showing. You have higher temperature, and then you see that if you measure the exposure, sensitivity, adaptive capacity, vulnerability as a whole, summing up the three factors, there's a particular spatial structure where those things are located. When you measure why those quarters of the city are vulnerable, what you find there is not a lack of green infrastructure as many planners or scientists are thinking. You think correlation here is really, it's really low. And materials and water supply in this case. So again, this informality is linked to those factors that can be traced in the sense of mass, in the sense of technomass, as I was saying in a moment. Okay, I have a little few minutes more, I guess, no? So to close my lecture now, with some messages. And the first one is the question of time. My full point today, it is to tell you that if we want to look at cities, being a little bit more specific, using some jargon, if you allow me, you want to understand urban form, we have to include time. Time is a fundamental component of urban form. I'm going to make the analogy with this beautiful painting, and this is Rembrandt. No? This is the moment when the human body stops being a temple, and they start to explore inside to see what is going on. And we learn actually a lot, but you're looking at that body. It's an equilibrium with that room, no? Now we do something else. We look at living bodies. So when you are not including time, looking at aspects of sprawl, I could be citing you, sprawl, not including time, and saying some cities are sprawling and they are not including time in that, or in heat, or in terms of informality, thinking that informal is linear and they don't see that it can be regressive, you are looking basically at the dead body. We learn a lot looking at the dead body up to the 20th century, but now it's time for us to start to look at the living thing. So time is a fundamental component of urban form, and that is one of my messages today. The second one, it is connected with the split between nature and society. We have to move to a scheme where we can see that we are co-producing things because we are basically nature. It's not that nature is somewhere there and we are here split from that, you know, or sent away from heaven. So nature is inside us. We have 1.5 kilo of bacteria in the digestive system that are helping you to digest your food. We are symbionts. You are surrounded by microbial colony, an ecosystem of microbi in the place where you are sitting today, all around this room. You cannot see that, but not because of that, it's not there. We are one with nature and we have to get back to that. And that is a really strong conceptual challenge, especially for our Western understanding. Cities are not an object. This is a literal thing. This is the city of, well, the plan for the city of Brasilia, I'm showing many times in my lectures. Cities are rather processes. In this case, for the designer, Lucio Costa, he got many prizes for this. This was an airplane, it wasn't a city, it was not thinking in terms of time. The day this city was open to the public, it was already overcome by the growth because the neighborhoods for workers were not included in the plan. So we have to really, really promote a paradigmatic change in the way we plan urban system. And this is especially for students that are into the planning thing, you know, interested into that. We cannot control urban form as a bonsai. We have to find actually innovative ways to deal with this thing, you know, including this idea of processes, you know, and try to, of course, to conduct these processes in the way we would like to. And well, that's a big challenge. Future cities, like in this RIBA design urban competition, are not about floating structures here or there, and more really to the ground. No, to the problems, what I was saying today, how to face them. No. Innovation has to come there, basically, not in designing things that are actually impossible. And also a little bit of humility in the way we look at the way we relate to nature, or the way we want to master nature. No. This thing of climate-proof cities, it sounds to me just like, I mean, nonsense, or like European Union zero land consumption, zero land take. We are far from those. We are far from having climate cities. We are far from having zero land consumption. We have to change the way we are thinking. And that is what I hope I can put the seed into student young generation to start to think about these old problems in a new way. And also a message for us doing things. I strongly believe in the new science of cities. This is a beautiful book, written by one of the most outstanding scholars in terms of analysis of urban systems as complex systems, Professor Batty, but there is no ecology. no one single hint to ecology in that full book, and that is missing. We have to start to think in terms of ecology when we are looking at cities. Because cities are ecosystems. No, my little friend there is reminding me that they're not drawings. No, as sometimes in the past I like to see it. As I said, are ecosystems, and there are processes taking place, and you have to use time to understand those processes. My point in terms of replicability of science here is, remember in the beginning I said dichotomy, black or white. Technomass is an invitation to measure and understand urban as a continuous process. When a climatologist, urban climatologist, they do measure, what they're interested to measure temperature, they're not coming back to you telling you, oh, this city is hot. Oh, this city is cold. No, no. They tell you that 18 degrees, 20 degrees, 25 degrees. That is what you read. It's a continuous way of measuring a phenomenon. We're still stuck in the 19th century saying this is urban, this is rural. We need to start to express the thing in scientific terms. And for that, mandatory in science is to use a continuous way of expressing a phenomenon and to step out from categories. And that is gonna help us also in comparability. Not making the mistake of Professor Stabinski there, no, comparing things that are actually not possible to compare. The categorical understanding to a continuous understanding of what urban means. This is the metabolism. Everything that gets in a system has to get out, not only heat, but output, waste, pollution, etc. We have to be able to move back to close this loop, as other ecosystems, they do, forests, coral ecosystems, they do that. They close materials, you know, the cycles. That's the only way. Because we live up to the 20th century thinking like cowboys, that there was always more space to conquer. I come from Patagonia, actually. Huge space to conquer, to do stuff, to profit, to get resources. That was the paradigm until the 20th century. For the 21st century, our only option is to start to think as astronauts. Everything is limited, and we have to make the best use of absolutely everything if we want to build a future for our kids and our grandchildren. Thank you very much.